Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'll be talking about how you can create some amazing web applications using TensorFlow Hub, an open source library in Python called as Gradio, which is gaining a lot of popularity. And if you have an idea in terms of creating a machine learning model, I'll show you using pre-trained models how you can, from the idea stage, read at the web application stage with very few lines of code, with say if there is no pre-trained model that is directly available, how you can use say retraining, a process which I'll kind of cover in the entire session as well, how you can retrain your model with your data and then come up with a machine learning model that is fine-tuned for your particular data set. And finally, once you have everything in place, how do you deploy the model using a simple web application based library called as Gradio. So without wasting any further time, I'll kickstart the discussion. So I work as a senior data scientist at Colgate-Palmolive. I'm pretty sure the company is kind of renowned, everyone brushes their teeth, so so Colgate is the company that makes toothpaste. I also happen to run a YouTube channel wherein I teach machine learning data science, so if you ever search for my name on YouTube, you should find my channel as well. So I'll quickly move forward, all of this is not that relevant, but technically, the way I would start off this discussion, given that I have 20 minutes, is for every problem that you face, be it in software engineering or in machine learning, the one ideology that you have to keep in mind is, if there is something that is good enough that already exists, don't reinvent the entire wheel, just try to realign it to your problem statement and create a solution around it. Okay? So this is where this particular quote comes into picture. Don't reinvent the wheel, just realign it, which is what the crux of the entire talk will be. So machine learning is evolving every day. How many of you have heard of Llama 2, the model that was open sourced by Microsoft and Facebook very recently? ChatGPT is like an old story now. So Llama 2 has come up recently. So there's a lot of advancement that's happening in the ML space, wherein there are new models that are coming up almost every day, which is where it's kind of very relevant to keep an eye on what's happening. So Llama 2, just for context, is an open source model. It was trained on around 3.2 billion trillion records, and then the entire model was fine-tuned. So all of this is open source, right? But when you have to go ahead and use an open source model or a solution you have to build using open source, there are some challenges that everyone faces, right? So how do you use it? Not a lot of repositories will have good README structures in them, which is where it becomes really difficult to use that particular repository. Is it safe? Now, one piece that's kind of gaining popularity in the ML ecosystem is, how is the model trained, right? So training of the data, while creating the ML model, what kind of data was used? Was it safe? Was it, did it have an inherent bias into that particular data set? All of that, was that taken into account while training? All of these factors is something that you'll have to keep in mind. Is it fair? Is it the latest version? Like Llama 1 released in January, if I'm not wrong, this year, after ChatGPT came out. And we are in which month?
July.
So in July, we have the second version of Llama as well. So things are moving very rapidly. So you shouldn't be in a stage where you're using a model which was kind of, which looks really latest, but there are multiple versions that have come out beyond that as well, which is where, what do you do? How do you create an ML solution from your idea to the end solution stage is where TensorFlow Hub comes in. Before going into TensorFlow, TensorFlow is a library that was introduced by Google. It's an open source library. It has multiple facets to it. You can use, so whatever data you kind of feed into the model, all the data preparation can be abstracted out using TensorFlow. Then you can build machine learning models. There are various categories of models wherein you will find pre-trained models as well, but you can build machine learning models using TensorFlow. Then you can deploy models. So ideally, there's no point having your machine learning model in your system that's running fine, right? You'll have to create and you'll have to deploy the model so that you can use it later on as well, which is where you can deploy models. And then once you have a model deployed, chances are that every 4 or 5 months, you will have some amount of drift in your output as well. Given that the data keeps changing, your training data was something that was, say, historically used. So your model predictions would go off after a certain interval of time, which is where you'll have to monitor the output. If the output is changing significantly as compared to what your actual expected output should be, then you will have to retrain the entire model based on new data, and this entire loop of preparing data, manipulating data, then building the new model, all of this has to be automated, right? You cannot keep doing it in a manual process, which is where implementing MLOps solutions is also possible in TensorFlow, which is where now what I'll discuss is TensorFlow Hub. So TensorFlow Hub is like GitHub for machine learning models. So GitHub is that one place where you find multiple repositories, right? Open source repositories where you can find code, where you can find the inner working of the repository, how you can use that particular tool as well, right? A similar version for machine learning that has been open sourced by Google is TensorFlow Hub. You have various collection of models here. You have images, you have text, you have video, and you have audio. So in case of images, we saw a demo just before my session, right? Which was image recognition. So you have different classes which have been trained in that model using convolutional neural networks. And then you can detect which objects appear in your live video feed and all as well. Then you have text related models as well. Chatbots are really gaining a lot of popularity. People want to create chatbots for their internal database, which is like the biggest thing that companies and enterprise want today. So there are a lot of text-based models that are available right now. Images and videos go hand in hand. So if you can build a classifier that runs on image, if you have like a high-end system that can process multiple frames of images together, then you would have a video classification model as well. Then you have something related to audio. So if you have multiple people speaking, if you want to segregate which speaker is speaking at what instant, then you have models for that as well in TensorFlow Hub. This is what I've already mentioned. So these are the different categories of models that you will find. This is not an exclusive list. This is like a small mini list of models that are already present. Again, the other advantages. So there's also PyTorch that is very famous in the research community for machine learning. But the reason why TensorFlow, if you're looking to deploy it end to end, which is where TensorFlow gives you that flexibility. So you create a model, and if you have to implement an entire pipeline of retraining and the entire MLOps pipeline, that can be created using the TensorFlow extended suite. Then you have TensorFlow JS. If you happen to create a simple model that you think should run on the browser itself, then TensorFlow JavaScript or TensorFlow JS comes into picture. So you can take your actual model, pass it through a converter, convert that to TensorFlow JS, and then you have TensorFlow JS equivalent model. How many of you have heard of Arduino boards, Raspberry Pi boards? Most of you, right? So if you have to create machine learning models that run on edge devices, now one uniqueness about edge devices is they have very little CPU and they have very little memory to store like huge models, which is where you'll have to compress the current model so that it fits into the memory of that particular device that you're running on, which is where you can use converters from TensorFlow and deploy, say, machine learning models using TensorFlow Lite. Again, Coral is again a type of an edge device wherein you can deploy it on those edge devices and use the edge device for predictions. Okay. Now, how do you use it? Can anyone tell me which dog breed this is?
Poodle.
So we have an answer, poodle. It's like a half answer. There is one more word before poodle. I'll give you a hint that the first letter starts with T. It's a three-letter word. And it's not Tom.
Toy poodle.
We have the answer, right? So this particular dog breed is toy poodle. Now how do you use an existing model? So say for example, I have this hypothetical use case wherein a client has come to me, he's told me that I want you to create a solution that is able to detect dog breeds for me, right? So how do you go about creating a web application for such a situation? Will you use, so one way is you can use all the images that are available on Google, scrape through all the images, label them, and then create a classifier using, say, convolutional neural networks. But a smarter way could be try finding a pre-trained model that has most of the classes that you want to predict in that model itself. And that is something that you can kind of wrap around in a web application and use it for prediction. So I'll give you some bits and pieces of the code. Some will be pseudo code, some will be the actual code. But how do you go about doing, or how do you go about building an application like this? You import TensorFlow as TF. Can all of you see the screen? So you start off with TensorFlow as TF, TensorFlow Hub as Hub. Now images in a matrix format are basically three-dimensional. So you have three channels for the images. So whatever you capture in an image photograph, the JPEG file that you have, it will have three channels, RGB. And if you have a transparent image, you will have four channels, which is your PNG images, which are without the background. They have four channels. One is, so that is for the your alpha value, which is how much of transparency do you require. But in our case, we'll only stick to JPEG images, which is three-dimensional. But if you pass in for prediction multiple images, if you want like a batch-wise prediction, you will have this particular array as a 4D image. So here I've written batch, comma 224, comma 224, comma 3. So 224, comma 224 is the input image size that this particular model expects. And 3 is the amount of channels that are there when you pass in that particular image. I am using this particular model, which is the MobileNet V2 model. It has multiple categories of dog breeds already part of the inference or the prediction of this particular model. So what happens in this case is, I don't require, say, feeding in a new set of data to this particular model. I can directly use it as it is and make the predictions from this, okay? Once I have this, what I do is I have the set of images. I have downloaded the model, which is located in this particular location on TensorFlow Hub. I pass it through a function called as classify. Not a function, but basically a placeholder that I've kept that keeps the model in hand. Then what I do is, this particular output of this particular model would give me a list of probabilities. This current model has been trained on 1000 classes. So there are 1000 unique classes of images that this particular model can predict. Out of those 1000 classes, the probability scores for every classes have been listed out based on the image you pass in. The class that has the maximum probability is the class that the model is predicting in our case. Okay. So for example, toy poodle will lie in a particular value, say randomly I'll pick 345, right? So 345th class is what the model says is the actual class of this particular image that it sees, right? Currently what I've done is I'm passing in only one image. So when I pass in the image, the output that I get is class 266, and corresponding to class 266, there will be a mapping file like a dictionary of sorts, which will have ID to class mapping, okay? So once the output of this particular, say, probability score is say 266, which is in our case class IDs would be mapped to a dictionary. The dictionary would give me the actual name of the image that is predicted, okay? So this current dog breed is toy poodle, okay? I told you that the client was very specific that he wanted a machine learning model which could classify dog breeds, okay? Not every client is that kind, right? He'll have a different expectation in mind. Companies would have different expectations in mind. They'll be like, we want something specifically trained on a particular data set. How do you now build a model? Do you start building things from scratch? Or do you use something that already exists? What would you decide at this point? Something that already exists, right? So there is this concept in machine learning called as transfer learning. Imagine how many of you write reviews on Amazon, Flipkart. If you're not happy with the product, generally that is the case. Yeah, so you will have two main categories of reviews, right? You will have positive reviews and you will have negative reviews on any particular product that you buy. Now, my company decides that, hey Bhavish, let's do one thing. Let's not have a classifier that only classifies reviews into two categories, positive and negative. Let's have a classifier that classifies into four categories, positive, negative, neutral, and sarcastic, for example. I'm just making up four different classes. But there are times that people have mentioned that this particular toothpaste is so great that it kind of made my teeth more black. So this is like a clear sarcasm, right? So how do you detect? So it's not a positive review it doesn't fall into a negative review. It's pure plain sarcasm, right? So how do you detect such cases as well, which is where you take an existing pre-trained model that was used for sarcasm detection. Again, I'm giving a very high level idea. Ideally, you would create four classes and create something from scratch. But in the case of transfer learning, the outputs that you see there are two classes, positive, negative. You feed in some input variables or input features. In our case, it would be text. What you do in case of transfer learning is the skeleton will remain the same because you're using the same set of features that are existing when you pass in the input, and you add the output layers to it. So I want four classes as output: positive, negative, neutral, and sarcastic. So this will be my four classes. There are different versions of how you can do transfer learning as well. One way is you retrain say five layers from the output. One way is you only retrain the output layer, which is what I'll cover today. So this particular section that you see, these set of weights initially would be randomly initialized. This particular model, right? So when you're taking an input, passing it through this particular model and taking a prediction, the entire model has learned the weights for the output connections as well, right? Which is this particular case. What I'm doing is I'm chopping off this region. I'm only taking the skeleton and I want to retrain this area again without tampering this particular region. Okay? This is where transfer learning comes into picture. You can iterate over how many layers you want to retrain based on the performance that you see in the model. But ideally, what I want to do is I want to obtain a pre-trained model. I want to chop off the final layer because I want to do it for certain sets of classes. Once I've frozen some layers, I train the new data set that I have with respect to this particular model, so that using backpropagation I'm able to learn the new weights of the final layers. I validate how good the model is. If I'm satisfied with the performance, I stick to that model. If I'm not satisfied, I'll chop off some more layers and I'll retrain it again. Okay? So this is the idea that you have to follow. And this is something that I spoke about, right? So I'll stick to an image classification task again because that is something that we've seen so far. Technically, whatever model I was using, so the layer that you see that has been crossed, this is the actual classifier layer wherein you have connections in between, and then you have the final output layer, which is the softmax layer. I chop off that layer and I add a new layer. Okay, but what is the task? The task in hand is I have some set of images with me. These images fall into five classes. All of them are basically flower categories. So you have sunflowers, you have daisy, you have dandelion, you have tulip, and you have roses, right? Okay. Now I want to create a classifier based on these five classes of images that I have. Again, this is entirely open source. You will find this data set on the TensorFlow website. So these are the five classes. One good thumb rule that you have to remember is once you have a data set in hand, try to have a data set which is equally labeled, so you should have approximately the same number of images for every class. Otherwise, if you're training, for example, a spam classifier, right? If you have 99% images, which are 99% emails which are not spam, and 1% emails which are spam, then detecting spam, the classifier wouldn't be able to detect spam that accurately, right? So here as well, you see almost equal distribution with some more images on dandelion, which is still fine. Now, how do I start the process? I have the images in the